Hi, welcome to our talk on how to write your own MVI system and why you shouldn't. My name's Matt, and I'm joined by Mikołaj.
Hello.
Combined, we have over 5 years' experience developing with MVI, and in that time, we've refined how we approach it. Today, we want to show you how to create your own MVI framework in less than 30 lines of code. Let's start with a quick introduction to MVI to ensure we're on the same page and use the same terminology. The best way to really think about MVI is to start with our user. The user interacts with the app, perhaps they click a button, and it's these sorts of actions that turn into intents. The intents are passed to the model, and it's the model's job to process these and link up to any network calls or business logic before generating a state and streaming that to the view. The view then renders the state into the UI. As a model may take time to process an intent, it is important that this cycle of data is non-blocking. Now let's take a closer look at the model. It's a model's job to ensure the integrity of the state and also that it is immutable to the outside world. But how is state changed? The intent goes through the transformer, which performs business logic, such as network calls. The reducer receives the result in the existing state, and from that generates a new state, which is then streamed to the view. Really, the process boils down to three key concepts. Data flows in one direction, processing of intents is non-blocking, and that the state is immutable.
So, you want to build your own MVI library. Where do you start? A good first read is the blog post that popularized MVI on Android. Hannes Dorfman wrote one of the first MVI libraries based on the Redux library for JavaScript. Jake Wharton's talk on the subject is also quite interesting. It presents how you can go about implementing MVI using nothing but RxJava. Garima Jain, in her talk, describes how to go from MVI using RxJava to MVI using coroutines. Here are some of the better known MVI libraries that you can also take inspiration from. Given there are already several MVI libraries out there, why would you write your own? We feel there's a mismatch between how simple the MVI concept is and how these libraries implement it in practice. We don't think they necessarily deliver on the MVI promise. Most of them have a high learning curve. Some of them overuse inheritance and force your code to behave in a certain way. Some of them have tons of boilerplate. If you're not happy with the compromises that existing libraries have, you might want to decide to write your own. The first thing you're going to have to figure out is how you write your multi-threaded code. And while you could use Java threading APIs, RxJava or Kotlin coroutines come with much less complexity. Having implemented MVI with both frameworks, and seeing as Google officially endorsed coroutines for Android, we recommend using Kotlin coroutines as a base. Coroutines present a much more readable approach to asynchronous code out of the two, and allow you to avoid streams completely for simple operations. To demonstrate how simple it can be with coroutines, we will show you how to create an MVI framework. We will demonstrate loading a list of posts and navigating to the details screen when you pick one of them.
So we have a basic fragment that doesn't really do much currently, but we do have some utility functions that will help us along the way, update list and navigate to details. We've got a view model wired in through coin, but equally you could be using Dagger. So let's click into the view model. We can see we just have a post repository wired up, and that itself has a get over views function. Okay, so where's the best place to start?
The state is the most important element of the model, so let's start with that.
Okay, so let's create the state class, postListState. Now we're going to need a list of overviews here, so let's create that. And we'll initialize that with an empty list, and we'll see actually this makes some things later on a bit easier. For the streamer states, we need a class that holds the current state and emits it upon subscription.
Not only that, but it also should emit only distinct state changes, and conflation is also nice to have. Fortunately, recent additions to the coroutines framework called stateflow and mutable stateflow tick all of these boxes.
To expose the state, we're going to create a mutable stateflow. Now, mutable state flow actually needs initial state, so we initialize that to an empty post list state. Since we want the mutability to be hidden, we use state flow publicly. And here we're using the column coding convention to prefix the backing field with an underscore. Back in the fragment, we now want to actually access that. So we're going to call viewModel.state and we'll use collect to extract the values. And then we can call our update list function that we've already got. Now this is actually a suspending function, so we can use lifecycle scope to wrap around that. So if we run that at the moment, we'll actually see it's just blank. But how should we approach loading up posts?
We need to send an intent to our model. In a traditional Redux style implementation, you would use a stream to deliver intents to your model. Intents are sent as a common supertype and later interpreted by something called a dispatcher to recreate that type information and invoke the correct flow. We don't think this is good enough. Type safety is very important, especially if you have many intents flying around. But who said we have to use a stream for intents? Why not simply invoke public methods directly on our view model?
Okay, so let's create a load overview function in the view model. And I'm just going to move that below the state. Of course, we can just use the post repository to get our list of overviews. However, getOverviews is a suspending function, but fortunately, we can wrap that with viewModelScope.
The beauty of using the viewModelScope is that when the viewmodel is destroyed, any ongoing network calls will be terminated.
What I'm going to do here is actually copy the state and just modify the value that's changed.
Yes, we copy to ensure that reductions are done in a cumulative and non-destructive way. This is especially important when the state has many fields that can be updated independently of each other. A slight issue with this implementation, though, is that many different threads could try and alter the state at the same time, so we need to protect ourselves from that. And one way to do that is to ensure that the state can only ever be modified from a single thread.
Okay, so good ideas. Now, JVM actually contains new single thread context, so let's just use that to create a single thread. And we'll create this in a companion object. And now we can wrap our state change with context single thread.
This looks great, but we don't want to have to remember to do all of that every time we want to do a reduction. We could improve the reusability of this code by splitting this into a reduce function.
Yes, good plan. So let's create a reduce function. Now, to actually make things simpler, we can actually use the postlist state as a receiver type for the lambda. And we'll see as we update the code how that improves things. Of course, now we should be able to run the app. And if we click on one of these items, we can see it displays a toast. Click on another one, again, toast is displayed. Now, of course, we don't really want it to display the toast, we actually want it to navigate. Navigation requires context, and the fragment is actually going to perform the navigation. So why should we create a function in the view model?
Generally, it's good practice to have a view which makes no business decisions by itself, a so-called dumb view. It's also nice to have all of your business logic in one place so that you can unit test it.
Okay, so let's create a function. We'll call this onPostClicked. and we'll provide the post to that. Okay, so let's just create then the view model. And I'll move that function up. Now, again, we want to do things within the view model scope, but actually, what do we put inside this function?
So some MVI approaches that we've seen suggest creating an optional field in the state to tell the UI when to navigate. However, navigation is typically a one-off event. So to stop navigation happening multiple times, for example, when you later return to your original screen, you have to ensure the field is reset once the navigation has completed. As you can tell, this can quickly get messy. Instead, a cleaner solution is to introduce the concept of side effects. A side effect is code that does not modify the state of the model, but still does some important logic outside of it. We can represent one-off side effects through a dedicated channel for events that should only be ever handled once.
So before creating the channel, let's create an event. So we'll create a navigate to details event. And we will use a buffered channel to hold the side effect. Now for the public field, can we just use a receive channel?
Actually, if we use a receive channel, someone could consume it, which cancels it after unsubscription, effectively making this channel one use only. Of course, we don't want that, so it's best to expose it as a flow.
Okay, so let's use flow, and actually what we'll see when we look at side effect, there is this receive as flow function which we can use. And then now here we can just do side effect send and create our navigate to details object. To help improve readability, we can actually break this out into a post side effect function.
While we are here, one more thing to tidy up would be cleaning up viewmodelscope.launch. We could put this in a function.
Yep, you're right. So let's create an intent function for this. And we're going to need a lambda. And for the lambda, we'll actually call this transform, because this is really what we're doing. We're doing the transformations within this. So we'll put the viewmodelscope in there and simply call our transform lambda. We can simply update our two functions in here and remove the wrapping of the view model scope. So that's certainly a lot neater.
Additionally, everything will run on the main dispatcher until you switch context. So coming back to MVI being non-blocking, we really do not want to block the UI. We may want to set the coroutine context to the single thread we've defined previously.
Yes, that's very true. So let's use the single thread. Now, of course, going back to the side effect, we need to actually listen to our new stream. So let's implement that. I mean, just copy and paste the original state code. Let's give that a quick run. And of course, we see it navigates as we'd hope.
Let's go back to the view model. This code isn't very reusable. Can we maybe break the framework code out into a separate class?
Sure. I guess it's going to contain our state, so we could just call this container. I'll move all our MVI code within that. Now, one thing to notice is view model scope isn't found. And actually, the reason for this is because, well, container isn't a view model. So we'll need to provide the coroutine scope. Now we need to actually create an instance of our container. So let's just do that. We'll just create file container and provide the view model scope to that. Now we can update the intents to prefix with the container. Now we'll see actually reduce isn't found. And the reason for this is because of the scope of the lambda. But what we can do is use a receiver type of the container. And now those functions are found. And we'll just quickly update the fragment to use the container.
This already looks much better, but the code's not generic. We still depend on post list types.
You're right, so let's introduce some generic type parameters of state and side effects. So now everywhere we see post list state, we're going to replace it with state. And everywhere where we see navigator details, we'll replace that with side effect. Now, of course, one thing that's missing from this is initial state, so we'll actually have to provide that. And of course, the generic types on the receiver type. And adding the type parameters into the container instance. And our default state. Let's give that a quick run. And again, we see that navigation still works. And so there we have it, MVI.
This is the complete code for our example. Simply MVI. There's no inheritance or boilerplate, and it all fits in less than 30 lines of code. So should you write your own MVI framework? Our recommendation is don't. The example we gave you was simplified. In the real world, an MVI framework needs more supporting features. For example, DSL scoping. Currently, there's nothing stopping you from, for example, nesting reducers. The threading model we used in this example is simplified, and it's not the most efficient. The framework is not unit tested, and it's not easy to test your view model either. There is no idling resource support for your UI tests, or saved state support for surviving process death. So why write your own when we did all of this for you? Orbit, our MVI library, offers an API that's quite similar to our example code. It has all the missing features outlined here and more, and we're not stopping there. We have a lot of nice features on our roadmap. A popular feature in some MVI libraries is time travel debugging, where you can record all the states emitted from a view model and then rewind and replay them. We're also planning to support screenshot and interaction testing, and making the library multi-platform. We hope we have demonstrated how easy MVI can be, and that you found this talk useful. We welcome you to visit our GitHub page. Thank you for listening.